Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Kamal. I'm part of a platform as a service team in PayPal. And today's topic is our evolution of containers in PayPal. So to start with, it's just the scale at which PayPal operates. The reason for this slide is we also want to talk about that something which looks very trivial, like for example, adoption of a Docker into a ecosystem becomes very complex when you look at a scale of this scale, right? Like where you have 3,000 services which are already running in production, which is serving customers, and it has been developed over last 10 to 15 years, and you want to bring new technology into such a scale and complexity. This talk is going to go through what we are doing to reduce that complexity and enable us for the future direction. So that is going to be the one of the main content is, it's not about technology, it's not about how do you use Docker. Some of the decisions which has been taken in PayPal for this evolution and why we choose the decision is going to be the main content of this topic. So as I already said, we have our own proprietary platform as a service, which enables developers today to deploy applications. So our current PaaS is completely a VM-centric PaaS, where every application, every developer has a own self-service to go into a portal and say, I need an application. They can create an application, and they can build it, deploy, test, and take it to production completely self-service. But the whole platform is built with VM-centric nature, which means that everything is VM, and they are running directly on the operating system. And we use a very legacy OS, which has been there for last 10 years. And that is one main factor for us to move out of that and go into a modern OS with modern kernel. Now, this slide is just to represent that a PaaS is a unique position where it gives you two views. One is a developer view, which is used by developers for creating new application, doing a build of their application, then testing it, and then deploying it. But this is more of an atomic view where your developer is managing one service. If your company has 10 services, then you have only 10 teams managing it. But we're talking about 3,000 services, and then another 1,000 of stateful application, and another 1,000 of batch applications. So which is like, if you look at it, it's like almost like 5,000 to 6,000 applications running in your site. That means that you cannot go to a complete DevOps model, right? A DevOps applies only to an atomic unit of the service which your developer is managing. But if you look at holistically your site, which is your entire thing, there is an operation teams which understands how the whole site works, how these services talk to each other. You cannot go completely DevOps in a company of our scale. That's why this PaaS is a unique one which has both the views. One view where we provide a self-service portal for developers to go and create application, deploy applications through API and everything. And other view where the whole 3,000 applications are combined and given as a site view to the operations to see how the business is operating. If there is an error, they should be able to pinpoint which service has a problem, right? That's where this view gives us that passes both the sides, not just one side of it. So as I said, like one of the things is that we, like 18 months back, PayPal as a company, we started looking at what should be our next generation of strategy. Like where should be in the next 18 months? So we looked at the current set of problems, what we have in production. Like for example, we have 100K VMs, which is running applications, and there's a lot of drift. The drift comes over a period of time that you apply patches and stuff like that, and then keeps going. So one of the major challenges with drift is that when an issue happens or when some site issue happens, it's very difficult to figure out why this VM has this configuration and another VM doesn't have its configuration. So in the future, we want to be completely immutable. I think there's a lot of talks which talked about immutability. Like you create a VM, you don't do anything. You basically, whenever you want to apply any change, you create a new VM. But if you want to be in that kind of an environment, you should be able to, your application should be portable. That means that when I create and destroy VMs, there should not be much dependency on your VM. Your application should be able to come up on any VM which comes out, right? That means that you need to be completely, your application should be completely portable. So that is one of the motivation for us to move to containers, that any application which is running in the site should be able to run anywhere, irrespective of what it is having underneath in the operating system. Now again, we always have these two views. One is a developer view and other is an operations view. As a developer, people are very excited. So Docker came out as a developer tool. Everybody was excited because they are able to create containers and run it on their containers in a laptop or anywhere they want. But the way we looked at it is that if we have to go and introduce Docker for 3,000 applications, we need to make all our developers a Docker expert. They need to understand the ecosystem. They should become, they need to know what to write into a Docker file, how to run it and everything. So we took a very different approach. The way we did that is we hide the complete Docker from end users, our developers. I'm going to walk through the process. So the developers were not introduced into the process when we introduced Docker into our ecosystem, but Docker got introduced to the developers later after the application was Dockerized. But still, these are the two perspectives where one is developers sees the view that, oh, I can try out a lot of new things by myself. But also on the operation side, it standardizes your operating system. It standardizes your whole systematic. Well, how do you deal with an application restart and stuff like that? Previously, if your application is running on an operating system, people used to understand the OS specific commands. Oh, I need to go and touch this file, start and everything. With Docker, it does, these are standardized set of commands which people have to execute. So the whole SOP becomes very standardized. So this is a typical PDLC lifecycle for any application. It doesn't matter PayPal or any company. You have your source code checked into a version control, and people have branches of forks where they keep developing. And then you go through a typical pull request model or a branching model where you commit. And then the commit gets built in your CI, where the CI is basically your build process based on your stack. If it is a Java stack with Maven, or if it's a Node.js, you run static analysis. It depends on what is your stack. And once that is done, you have a final artifact which can be deployed. Now, if you use any of your PaaS systems, they will have a deployable unit, whatever it is. So in our current system, the deployment unit is a tarzi, which is basically packages code into a tar file, and there is a script which knows how to start the application. Or if you go to, in case of Docker, it becomes a Docker image. So the output of your CI is finally a deployable unit. And then you take the deployable unit, you push it into your test environment where you validate your application runs, everything it looks good. And then you need a promotion process because you don't want every binary which is built into production because for a lot of reasons, security, certification, and stuff like that. So once your application is good, everything looks good on your dev QA, you move your application into prod. In this case, we are talking about Docker registry, which is hosting all your application images, which gets promoted. And then once it is promoted, when the final production deployment happens, it gets pulled from there and deployed into all the instances in production. This is a very typical PDLC lifecycle, which happens for most applications. So what we did in this is that we wanted to have a very clear layering strategy. So the point of adopting containers was not just because we want to use Docker. This was the stepping stone for us to build the next generation platform. Our next generation platform, we wanted to make it very lean and mean so that we should be able to upgrade any layer. So today, if you're going into a VM world, we have a lot of interdependencies. So let's say that you have an application and that application has a dependency on some system library. And then that system library has a dependency on the operating system and then kernel. There's a lot of dependencies which is making us very difficult to upgrade any layer. For example, I cannot go and just change the operating system without telling anybody, because everybody has to be informed, everybody has to make change. So one of the goals for our next generation platform is to make everything a clear layering so that any layer should be able to operate in its own. That means that if I want to upgrade the host operating system, we should be able to upgrade it without being saying that we have to go and test every application. If you layer it correctly and if you have the contracts between each layer, it becomes very easy. So similarly, when we adapted Docker, we came with this layering where we have the host operating system. There are talks about today about this Linux kit. Now, for a company like us to adapt, big companies to adapt that, it's very difficult. But this is a first step where we want to isolate that the operating system at the host level is the minimum level with the kernel and whatever is needed, and everything for application moves into the Docker layer. And then we build a Docker base layer, which is the minimum required thing to be there in the Docker image. And then we are a polyglot company. Basically, we have stacks which are based on Java, we have Scubs, Scala, and then we have Node.js. So that's why we have to build this base layer, which is can be used by other stack layers to build their own stack bases. Like Java will build their own stack. Node.js will have their own base. And then Scala will have its own base, right? And then when the application is built, the last layer is only nothing but your application gets copied into the last layer. So that means that your CI build, whenever your CI build happens, the final artifact of your CI is what is built into that application image. So in this way, what happens is that whenever there is a vulnerability found, let's say that there is a vulnerability in the base image, immediately we build a new base image and all the stacks build their new base image. And next CI build, which happens, will pick it. So the version of the base images are dynamically got from a metadata system so that it is not always static. It's never in the Docker file, what is the images. It's populated at the runtime of the build so that anytime a new image is built, it will be picked up. So in that way, we always use the latest images so that any vulnerability which is found is fixed immediately. So this is the whole process which happens in that. So I initially told you about that today our Docker developers, we have 3,000 applications. We cannot go and ask everybody to write a Docker file. So what we did is that in the GitHub where the app code resides, there's no Docker file or no Docker Compose file. They don't have anything. It's the same code which has been running today on a VM exists. We built a process called source to image, which understands that what the stack it is, if it is a Java stack or is it a thing. So whatever stack we support, we know that. And we have these templates per stack and configurations. So during the build time, these informations are pulled at the time of the build, after the build of the application happens, and then the images are created and it's pushed. So similarly, we have a metadata system where we host our compose files. So if you look at it, we have a base compose and then a QA version of a compose and a prod version of the compose so that when this whole thing happens, the final artifact of this thing is two things. One is the Docker image, your application image, which got built, and the Docker compose file, which got built during this based on the information. So these two information are published. The images goes into the Docker registry, and the compose file goes into our pass metadata system, which is used during deployment. In this way, what happened is that we were able to immediately take any application, Dockerize it, and push it into prod without having our developers to write a Docker file or a compose file. Now, what happened with this is that when the developers saw this, now they wanted a way to take this and run it on their laptop. So we did the reverse. We gave them a way to take this compose file and run it on their laptop. So in that way, they don't need to write anything. So that way, the adoption was very easy, and we were able to move faster without asking every developer to go and change their source code. Another thing which we started looking at is that since our applications are polyglot, we talked about it, some application needs containers to run along with their application. For example, Node.js is a classic example where they're in an Nginx container running along with their application to serve things. Now, when we have this architecture, we started looking at what's the best way to run them together. Now, Kubernetes came with the concept of a pod, which is very clearly defined, where it's a single network namespace, single process namespace, single user namespace, but all of the containers together provide a pod. Now, we thought, okay, this is cool, but how do we do it without, since we are not a Kubernetes shop, how do we do it? So we started looking at Docker Compose as a way to define that. So that's why we started using Compose, where a single Compose file defines a pod's definition. So it tells you these are the services and this is the configuration where we collapse the network namespace together, we collapse the process namespace, and all of them runs as a single pod. And in this way, what happened is that when we started going to the futuristic world of cluster management, where we want to deploy applications, we take the same pod concept and we can apply multiple pod on a VM where we can assign IP per pod. When we run on a single VM, it runs on the host mode. But when we move to a cluster management environment, every pod gets its own IP. So this is what our thought process is. So today on a VM, we run as processes. So if you look at it, a JVM runs as a process, JSW runs as a process. In case of Node, Node.js runs with some PM2 or anything to manage its own process, and then Nginx runs. Now, when we moved into the pod model, we took everything. So we have other containers like logging containers, which basically takes, it's like Fluentd, which basically takes and pushes to centralized system. We have security containers, which basically enables you to pass secrets and stuff like that. Now, there's a lot of containers written. So what is the first step was to take all this process and then convert them into a pod model, which is basically a compose, right? And then take that compose and deploy it on a VM. And now, it's a single VM running one single pod in the host mode, but as all the components containerized, right? That's the first step because we have a lot of code and we have to containerize everything. So this is the best way to first get them just run as containers. And once they are there, we will be moving them into the next step. When we move to a cluster management environment, the pods will have only application and application sidecar, and everything else will move into a system pod, which is like a singleton per host. That means like, for example, logging, like Fluentd, it's an example, will run here where all these pods will start sharing it. In this way, the evolution becomes very clear that once we do one step, we are standardizing it so that we can move faster in the future. And also one more thing is the operating system change. So I was talking about we are running a very old kernel and an operating system here. We want to move out of that, right? The best way to move out is that we change the operating system, the host. So we bought a latest kernel, latest version distribution here, but we are maintaining the old operating system inside the containers. So this way, what happens is that the applications are still things that, oh, I'm running on the old operating system, but we moved out of that and we bought the latest kernel. Now in the future, we can change the operating system underneath also, as well as the container operating system with just a switch. It doesn't require much. So the main focus here was not just adopting these technologies, but also providing us a way path forward so that when we want to change, we should be able to change faster. Now, so we didn't do that here, at least going forward, we should be able to do that. So the other thing is that we use the Docker Trusted Registry heavily. So for us, DTR provides the source of truth for all the images. So we have a pretty big usage of DTRs where all the CI builds today publishes a version of it image to this. So there are certain things we work with Docker to make it better. For example, we always feel that any image which is uploaded to a registry should be immutable, right? Today, people can go and overwrite a version. You can basically upload it. We prevent it on our side, but today DTR allows us to do. And similarly, we have this process where any images which is built on the QA is only available for QA side of it. That means the developer can test, but it cannot go to prod unless it is certified. So what is certification means? The certification means multiple things. One is that your QA has to approve, right? Your build has to be certified by your QE team saying that everything is validated. It looks this, there's no issues. Second thing is a security validation. Somebody has to scan the image, provide a CV report, and say nothing happened, everything looks good, this image is certified. And then it could be a signing. So there's a lot of things which is built into this whole promotion. And then once it is all good, then it moves to the production. That means that only the golden images which are ready to be deployed in production are moved into prod. And it also gives another advantage. I said that every build pushes images into there. That means the size grows very fast. So we use a lot of space right now. That means that we need to clean up regular basis. So now, since it's a QA version, we can clean up more aggressively without worrying about, oh, we may lose this and production cannot deploy. Because in production, the image should be available for rollbacks and a lot of things. But in QA, it's okay even if you lose it. So that gives a good manageability aspect of having this whole distribution across. And we have a whole process of how to do the cleanup. Basically, DTR allows you to mark, it's a two-phase delete. Basically, you mark the images and then you run a GC to claim space. So we have to run our own algorithm to figure out which images are being used in prod, we always keep a last N versions available for rollbacks and stuff like that. So that's another process which has been done. So the final thing is about, so when we build the whole system, our past deployment used to deploy all application to a VM cluster. Now what we have to do is we have to change our application deployment so that it can support both simultaneously. That means that application can be deployed in the old way as well as in the Docker way, which allows us to flex a few VMs into a Docker-based one, test everything looks good without compensating on the current deployment model. So in that way, once everything looks good in this model, we totally migrate out into Docker. This way that the migration is very clean and application can do one VM testing, a 10 VM testing, make sure everything looks good, and then it's... There are a lot of challenges. I'll just skip through this. It's basically the mindset. People write local logs. They think everything will be available after application deployment. So how do we deal with that? And finally, there's a lot of things we started working on it along with this. One is the desktop experience, how people can take this whole Compose, run it on their local. What do you do with the security, for example, scanning? Do we need runtime scanning? There's a lot of questions which are being answered, and we are building our next generation PaaS on top of an orchestration system, a cluster manager, and we are building a network stack for containers, which will provide an IP per pod and everything, which is all on work. I think hopefully by next DockerCon, we'll have talks on them. Thank you.